Good evening, friends, and welcome to this session on the top 25 lean tools. Let me just share the screen for a moment. Okay. So, friends, there are several lean manufacturing tools and a lot of ideas and principles which are associated with lean. Most of these tools should be implemented within the main principles of lean, and also as part of a clearly defined and planned rollout to improve your business. Each of the tool can be implemented on its own. However, the greatest value will always come as part of a comprehensive implementation of the lean. And these tools are suitable for all forms of businesses and can be applicable for both manufacturing as well as the service companies. Obviously, in case of the service companies, some of the tools will not be directly applicable, but the principles of the lean will still, you know, continue to apply over there. In my career, I have been always asked about, you know, which are the most important lean tools, because there's so many of them. There are several, you know, such kind of the tools that people do get confused about, that which are the, you know, top tools which we should use. So that's when I thought that why not put together a list of top 25 tools as per my own limited understanding. And chances are that you may find a specific tool missing here when I talk about it today, which you may think it is very important. So it doesn't mean that, you know, I'm not considering that particular tool, but this particular tool may not have been on my list of the top preferences. So that's how it is. So I'm going to talk about the 25 lean tools which I think are very important, which any kind of a manufacturing or a service company on the journey to lean should be putting it together and using it. For the ease of understanding of these tools, what I've tried to do is I've tried to group them in various categories, and we will, you know, investigate each of the tools pertaining to that category. So the categories which I put together are the planning and project management, understanding performance, understanding cause and effect, designing and analyzing processes, data collection, and of course the implementation solutions. Okay. And then there are a couple of them which I'm putting them into the others category, and we will also talk about them as we go into that. Lead journey will always start from the planning and project management, and we will cover some of the tools which are applicable over there. Once again, this list is not going to be comprehensive. This is going to be the top ones which I think we should be looking up into. So the first tool in my list is PDCA, or the Plan, Do, Check, Act, which is a four-step method for creating and carrying out the changes. PDCA method is a cycle and is repeated over and over again in order to drive the continuous improvement. PDCA is primarily used in four situations: conducting an improvement project, designing a repetitive work process, developing a new process or product design, and implementing changes in the manufacturing processes. So these are the four stages in which we use the PDCA. The four steps of the PDCA include plan, which is find an area that needs improvement and plan a change, do, that is the test the change on a small scale, check, that is checking how the test went by and analyzing the results and determining what you have learned, and act finally, which is take actions based on what you have learned. If the changes you made did not work, start from the beginning and determine a different test. Use your failures to determine where you will go next. Okay, so this is where, you know, the four steps of the PDCA include. Since it's a just 1 hour session, I'm just going to quickly, you know, browse through most of these tools. So I'll not be getting into the details of each of the tool, but just give you an orientation, give you an awareness, and also tell you that where these tools can be actually used into. So the next tool on my list over here is the Hoshin Kanri, or as is known as the policy deployment. Okay. Policy deployment is a 7-step planning process, and it involves a systematic method to meet strategic planning goals and manage progress towards those goals. The goal of the Hoshin Kanri, or policy deployment, is to determine your strategic objectives and then align them with specific resources and action plans so that you can meet those objectives. The 7 steps of the Hoshin Kanri are, I'm just going to quickly walk through, not dwell too much on that. 1, determine an organizational vision, which is figure out what your current mission and long-term vision is. Establish breakthrough objectives, but that is determine what significant improvements a business needs in the next 3 to 5 years. 3, come up with annual objectives to complete on a yearly basis. Fourth, determine metrics to measure the objectives. Fifth, implement objectives. Sixth, review objectives on a regular frequency. And the seventh, review the objectives on a larger frequency, probably on a yearly basis. So these are the seven steps on which the Hoshin Kanri is established on. So that's the second tool which I would be talking about. The third tool, and you might find it slightly strange because Kaizen is not usually used into the planning process, but it can also be still used into the planning process, and it can also be used into the continuous improvement side. Okay. So quickly, Kaizen is a Japanese word for continual improvement, Kai and Zen, change and good. Okay. The term refers to activities that improve every function of a business and is generally applied to manufacturing, but can be used to make almost any business more efficient. Even in service also, you can use it. Okay. Kaizen includes all the involvements of everyone, all the employees, whether it is from the top management to assembly line workers. And it can be used to improve every process in a supply chain from purchasing to logistics. The lean manufacturing tool, Kaizen, was first used by the Japanese in World War II. And it was a major influence of the book called The Toyota Way. Okay? So Kaizen seeks to improve standardized processes in order to eliminate waste, fix workflow issues, and solve business problems. So we use it essentially into the planning from a perspective of saying that what are the areas where we really need to focus upon and what kind of the standardized processes are required into it so that we can eliminate the waste. So that's a perspective why we use it into the planning as well. Okay. Kaizen, I'm sure that a lot of people would say that it is most applicable to the automotive industry. In fact, the Toyota production system made this particular tool famous. And if the problem occurs within the production process, Toyota assembly line personnel and their supervisors are expected to stop the production process and begin a Kaizen. That is, identify how to improve upon that particular part and what needs to be changed and how to manage that particular improvement project. Okay, so that is the third tool which I put in my list. On this project and planning side, apart from the PDCA, Hoshin Kanri, and Kaizen, you can use host of the other tools, which could be RACI metrics, daily planning, and so on and so forth. I'm not going to go into it. As I said, they are not on my top list over here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up each of the category, identify the top tools from my side. And in the end, I'm going to pick up the other significant tools, which can also be used by the into those particular categories by others. So RACI metrics, daily planning fall into the same thing. Next category is understanding the performance. So understanding the current performance and continuously reviewing it equally is equally necessary as implementing a solution. Okay. I have identified over here three tools and we will talk about that. First one, which I've identified here, is the bottleneck constraint. Okay. I'm not sure if most of you are, you know, aware about the theory of constraint. Bottleneck constraint comes from the theory of constraint itself. Okay. So bottleneck in a supply chain refers to the resources that take the longest time in operation. For an example, when hiking, a bottleneck would refer to the slowest member of a hiking group. So if you have got 15 people and one guy is very, very slow into it, he's the one who is going to determine the speed of the entire group because you can't leave him behind. So everybody has to slow down accordingly. And this is exactly what happens in the process of manufacturing. Okay. So if one part of a supply chain is unnecessarily slow, it can reduce the speed and efficiency of entire manufacturing process. So that's why bottleneck constraint becomes a very important tool over here. The goal of bottleneck analysis is to determine the slowest part of the manufacturing process and then figure out how to speed them up. The process can be costly, but this always leads to, you know, increased efficiency and profits. And if you ignore a bottleneck issue, it can over a period of time be very, very costly in the entire manufacturing cycle. We use this bottleneck analysis tool when the managers or operators suspect that the manufacturing process is taking too long. At this particular time, we ask the managers to try to determine exactly where the bottleneck is occurring and then try to address that. So that's a fourth tool, which is important in my list. The next tool is OEE, or overall equipment efficiency, We did have a session on the overall equipment efficiency itself in detail. So I'm not going to go more in detail, but rather refer to it as an important tool. This is a system which we use to measure the manufacturing productivity. And it measures the percentage of time that a manufacturer is truly productive, which again, as we talked in that session, if it is 100%, it would mean that manufacturer is productive 100% of the time. Okay. And as we had talked earlier, OEE includes measurement of quality, performance, and availability. By measuring the productivity in terms of time, manufacturers can gain the insights into how to improve overall manufacturing performance, and OEE helps to identify waste, track progress, improve manufacturing equipment efficiency, and so on. So that's why it is very important, because if my machines are not running efficiently, my manufacturing performance is not appropriate, I will not be able to improve my overall productivity. The next on the list is tech time. Okay. Tech time is something, you know, which a lot of people use it knowingly or unknowingly. Probably in future, we might do, a complete session on that, because tech time is very, very important to manage the things on the shop floor. Okay. This tech time is a word which comes from the German word called Pulse. And it is the maximum amount of time a product needs to be produced while still meeting the consumer demand. Once you have a tech, then it creates a rhythm across the supply chain to ensure the continuous flow and fully utilize the available resources. And goal of the tech is to deliver the right product to the right customer at the right time, all with the minimal waste. Okay? So it ensures that products are manufactured in the most efficient way while meeting the consumer demand. Another goal of the tech time is to create a solid flow of operations within the supply chain. If you measure the tech time, it will allow the managers to determine the capacity and synchronization issues within a supply chain and then find the proper solution. So that's the reason why I place a high importance on the tech time. So like the, So like the earlier section, apart from the three tools which I talked about, you can also use the QC tools. You can also use the KPIs. You can also use the cost of quality and host of other tools so that you can understand your manufacturing performance better. But again, I picked up only the three as a relevant ones over here right now. Okay. The next category which we have identified is understanding cause and effect. Okay. And understanding the cause and effect of the causes, as well as the solutions to be implemented, this always helps in taking the right corrective actions in time. Over here, again, there can be a host of the tools. I have selected only one very important tool over here, which is called root cause analysis. Okay. So root cause analysis is a lean problem solving method that aims to get to the root of a problem. The philosophy of RCA, or root cause analysis, is predicated on the idea that it's best to treat the root cause of a problem, not the obvious symptoms. Okay. Most of the time, we try to treat the symptoms, and the root cause forces that symptom to reoccur in a different way, and that doesn't help us. So that's why it is very important that we, treat the root cause. And if we treat the root cause, then we can eliminate the larger problems down the road. Okay. Again, root cause analysis will generally not fix the problem in one try, and is generally a very iterative process over here. Okay. Main principles of root cause analysis can include the aim of root cause analysis. If I come back and I'll come into the steps later on. The root cause analysis, I would use it to identify the real cause of a problem in order to prevent it from ever occurring again, which means that it is a long-term solution. It's not a very tactical and quick fix kind of a solution. We would do the root cause analysis in a way which turns out to be investigative and have a systematic process so that it works very effectively. And also we need to be very clear as a principle of root cause that every problem doesn't have multiple root causes. Every problem has only one root cause. Okay. So if we go by these kind of the three principles and then, follow these four steps, define the problem, determine the causal relationships, identify effective solutions, and implement and track the solution, then you can use the root cause analysis very effectively. Another common thing which happens when we try to do this thing is we can also use the five whys, that is, ask the whys five times. And each time we do that, it takes us one step closer to discovering the true underlying root cause. Okay? So to me, root cause analysis is a major tool for understanding the cause and effect. Okay? As I mentioned, there can be a host of the other tools. You can use the five whys, you can use the various QC tools, you can use the A3 thinking, 8D problem solving, and so on and so forth. There's several other tools which you can use for, you know, understanding the cause and effect over here. The next category we have identified is designing and analyzing processes. Okay. So this designing and analyzing processes is very necessary at depth and is required at depth to ensure that implementation of solution is in right direction and is able to produce the required results. If we have not analyzed and designed our processes correctly, implementation of solution can go haywire. Okay. So here we use the tools like the first one we would use is the value stream mapping, which is again a lean tool, and it uses flow diagrams to depict every step of a process. It shows the current and the future state of processes in a way that highlights that where we can really improve upon. Okay. People would have seen different kind of value stream mapping charts also. I've used a very simple one to show it over here, but these value stream maps can also be very complex based upon the type of the value stream you're working with. Okay. Value stream map serves three main purposes. It identifies the waste, it reduces the manufacturing time, and it makes the entire manufacturing process more efficient. Okay. We can apply the value stream mapping to almost any kind of industry, but normally I would use it more for logistics, supply chain, product development, and even the administrative processes. Okay. Some of the data which we collect for the value stream mapping, I'll just list it out, which is a standard way of collecting it. Inventory, number of operators we have, number of shifts we are working on, the batch size of the production, time it takes to make one product, time it takes to switch from one product to the next, and how much time factory can run. Okay. So if these values, if you really understand and if you try to, you know, capture them, then it will capture a lot of information. It will also help you to calculate the, you know, tech time, idle time, non-value added times, value added times, wait periods, cycle times, you know, defects, wastages, and so on and so forth. So this itself, just doing this itself helps you to, you know, really plan out your entire operations properly. The next tool for the designing and analysis of the processes is the continuous flow. Okay. Now, continuous flow is actually opposite of the batch production and is very closely associated with the Kanban and just-in-time kind of the tools. Goal of the continuous flow is to use ongoing examination and improvement to integrate all elements of the production. By aiming for a continuous flow production process, waste and other problems come to the surface. And once you know that where the waste is happening, then you can actually work upon it and solve it out. Okay. However, you would require a lot of lean principles and tools, you know, to make the continuous flow a really good continuous flow. And on the other end side, once you have a continuous flow production process, it will also use a lot of lean principles and tools to, you know, make that an effective one. Okay. This process generally involves a factory running on a 24/7 without interruption and with little waste. Companies like oil refinery, metal smelting, natural gas processing, these are some of the industries which are, you know, ideal for the continuous flow process. Even the process industries, even the food manufacturing and so on, can also be, you know, very ideal for looking up at the continuous flow. Okay. Even in the automobile also, where you have got a continuous on a high speed assembly going on, you can also use the continuous flow as part of that as well. Okay. If you use the continuous flow, if you can deploy that, then it will help you to achieve four things: better stability, better continuity, wasteless process, and, you know, no time wasted, no wait period involved into it. So that's the third process, which second process which we are talking about as part of the process analyzing and designing. The next to that is one piece flow. And one piece flow in a way is pretty, you know, similar to the continuous flow, but slightly different over here. So one piece flow is the sequence of a product or a service through a process that is one unit at a time. Okay. One piece flow is again opposite of batch processing, where a large number of products could be created at once, and then they are sent for the manufacturing process as a complete batch or a large group. Okay. In one piece flow, the focus is that you manufacture one product itself completely rather than waiting, transporting, and storing of this product between the different processes. Okay. Once you have the one piece flow, then the advantages can be you have a higher ability to detect defects earlier and more accurately, more flexibility for customization and meeting the customer demands. You can reduce the cost by eliminating the waste, reduce the amount of work in progress to make each step more efficient, and easier to predict shipment times. Okay. So these are the benefits if you have the one piece flow. To increase the efficiency, companies do choose to implement the one piece flow or to simply reduce the number of products produced in a particular batch. Okay. So when you have a large product mix also, that time also one piece flow can help you to have a better batch efficiency by applying these kind of the principles over here. The next tool, which is into the planning side or designing and analyzing process side, is the cellular manufacturing. Cellular manufacturing is again a very important concept, and large manufacturings are now reverting to this. They are, you know, establishing this more and more rigorously. So cellular manufacturing essentially is a process of producing similar products in one cell. One cell is a workplace area where everything happens over there itself. Okay. So the product in the cellular manufacturing moves through the production processes within a single unit without any kind of an interruption. Using the cellular manufacturing, we can make the similar products on the same assembly line. Okay. So this becomes another important part about the cellular manufacturing. The cellular manufacturing can include grouping similar products together to reduce time of changeover, effectively utilizing the space during the entire production processes, increase the flexibility and transparency, reduce the lead time, increase overall productivity, and enhance the teamwork and communication between employees and department. So that's where we use the cellular manufacturing over here. Wherever we need to increase, leverage these kind of the benefits, we will look up at the cellular manufacturing. Okay. The I think, let me take a small example. Probably that would also, you know, help you to understand, because you suddenly would be seeing a lot of, you know, red lines over here and arrows crisscrossing and so on and so forth. So let's say, you know, a metallic component comes to the factory, and it a large number of the metallic components come to the factory, and they have to be now, you know, shaped and assembled together. And to do this thing, the assembly, it requires a variety of the different steps. If that is what happens, then in that case, our goal of setting up a cellular manufacturing could be that all the steps occur in one area, in a one single work area. They move into a logical sequence of operations, and it starts from the left side or right side and ends up on the other side after going through all the processes. And if that happens, then you would get the complete product out right from one single place only. So blanks, they go into turning, then they again go into a second level of turning, they go into a drilling, they go into hobbing, maybe there is a shaping involved, then there is an induction hardening, there is a different levels of the grinding, and at the end of it, let's say you were supposed to manufacture a gear and your gear is ready. So you are not moving the things from one area to a grinding station which is somewhere else, or to a hardening, induction hardening to somewhere else, and so on and so forth. So they're all integrated into one single location. So that's the cellular manufacturing. So are these only the tools? No, there are more tools which you can do. Some of the tools which you can use over here are the process flow charting. You can use the value analysis. You can use the material flow. You can use the spaghetti diagrams. You can use the waste analysis. You can use various kind of the process flow charting tools which can be used. In fact, I also use the spaghetti and the material flow diagram very heavily, though I have not mentioned it over here. But the The other tools which I mentioned are the more important than these specific ones. Okay. The next set we have identified, or the category we have identified, is the data collection. Okay. I am sure that you all will appreciate that appropriate and timely data collection always will form the backbone of the lean manufacturing. And if you don't have the appropriate data and timely data, you will not be able to take the right data, kind of the decision. However, even carrying out the observations, interactions, and interviews are also very important apart from the pure data collection. And that's why I picked up a tool which is not purely into data collection, but rather is a tool called Gemba. So in Japanese, the word Gemba means the real place. And in business, it refers to an area where the value is being created. Okay. So in manufacturing, the value gets created on the factory shop floor. And in a maybe construction site, it is in a construction business, it's a construction site, or in a sales team, the sales floor is, you know, the place where the value is getting created. But it always talks about where the value is being created. Go over there and see what is happening. Okay. So idea of the Gemba in lean manufacturing is that management must go to the factory floor to search and fix the visible problems. Okay. You just cannot sit into your room and anticipate everything to be working fine. Manufacturing problems, the Gemba guys will always argue, cannot be solved from an office. You have to be there on the shop floor. This requires an actual physical presence by the problem solvers on the manufacturing floor. So Gemba is all about that. And Gemba walk refers to staff taking the time to walk through the factory, examine what is going on, and determine if there are any issues. In the lean management philosophy, I would say staff is expected to do the Gemba walks at least once a week. Okay, that's a frequency normally we recommend over here. Again, Gemba is also a step-by-step process. Engineers physically go to the manufacturing floor to observe the processes. Engineers collect the data and understand the work being done. Engineers ask the questions, and then engineers learn about the problems and come up with the solution. So these are the step-by-step kind of the processes over here. We don't try to solve the problem on the shop floor. We try to understand. We try to collect the data. We try to ask the question and learn from the people who are working on the shop floor, come back, analyze everything, and then try out the applications, try out the new ways, and then see if it is effective, and then institutionalize. So that's Gemba. Okay. Again, other tools, a lot of other data collection tools can be there. Check sheets, I could do a lot of benchmarking, time and method studies, work sampling, man-machine charts. We can do, you know, n number of the other tools also. But Gemba walk turns out very, very important because that helps you to not just collect the data, but also combine the observations and help you to actually start improving upon it. Okay. So that's the other tool. Okay. So now we will come to a section which is implementing solutions. And there are large number of the tools once again over here. Each tool serves its own specific purpose. Many of the tools work in tandem with each other. It's not that, you know, the tools will work absolutely independently, though most of the tools can work independently also, but in tandem along with other tools, they work far better. Okay. So I'll be talking over here about the 11 total tools which could be effectively used over here. And the topmost priority on my list is the 5S method. Okay. Again, I'm not going to talk about the 5S method over here. 5S is known to everyone. We all know that 5S provides a workplace organization method. And we use the 5S in eliminating the waste, which again comes out from the poorly organized work area. Okay. So we are not going to discuss more on the 5S, but 5S, you know, sort, set in order, shine, standardize, and sustain. The 5S's is the topmost tool into implementing a solution. And if you also recall, when we talked about the 5S, 5S also is the bottommost part of the house of lean, which provides you the stability to the entire house. Okay. So that's the first tool over there. The next tool which I picked up is the JIT, just in time, or JIT. Okay. Just in time again is a lean tool. which calls for the production of what a customer wants, when they want it, in the quantity they want it, and where they want it. Okay, so it's all totally linked up to what the customer wants it and addressing only the exact requirements of the customer. Okay, so JIT advocates that you don't create a larger stock of product, which then continues to sit in the warehouse. Rather, you create only as much as the customer requires. And if you do that, this actually reduces unnecessary inventory and ensures that the companies spend only on the stock that will always be paid for by the customer. Okay, and we all know that if the inventory is locked up, you also have large amount of the money locked up, because inventory is not going to come cheap to you. You would have spent some money in creating that inventory, and money also gets locked up along with the higher inventory volumes. Okay, just a quick background. Just in time again was invented by Toyota during the World War II, and it was invented at a time when producing extra stock was simply too expensive and not possible, because in the World War II, the resources were at premium everywhere. The need was to fuel the war supplies, and that time companies could not, you know, really afford to produce as much as they wanted. So they could only afford to produce what a customer could actually pay for, so that you have your money circulation going on. Okay? And also another thing, this idea of the just-in-time also actually originated from the US supermarkets, where the Toyota manager saw that the frontline shelves were only filled when a product ran out and not before that. So if my shelf got emptied out, then only I would be replenishing it. So that gave an idea of just-in-time, and that has become a major, major tool into managing an inventory. Okay. The next tool, which is people again, you know, take the visual management as something which is basically putting up some signs, putting up certain marks and so on and so forth, but it is way, way beyond that. Okay. I think we did a session on the managing the losses using the visual controls, and we talked at length that, you know, how the visual controls can, you know, help you to reduce the losses. Visual management is actually a communication technique which uses the visual aids to convey the message quicker and very efficiently. Okay. And objective of the visual management is that you clarify the waste, you display the problems in a very simple way, you clearly indicate your efficiency goals, and you increase your effective communication. Okay. So visual management is another important tool, which I thought I should bring it up over here. Stock controls, auditing boards, shadow boards, all of these are the examples of the visual management. Okay. And if you have a good visual management, your communication with your team also can improve substantially without your, you know, really trying to push a lot of things and a lot of interactions. Similarly, you can also simplify the work instructions and make them easier to understand if you add up the visuals into that. Okay. For an example, a work must build a, whenever you are on the shop floor and building something, let's say you're building a piece of furniture from multiple parts, it will become very easy if you have a visual format which will help you to assemble them back. Okay. I'm not sure whether I shared this in the earlier ones or not, but if you take up the IKEA furniture and if you order the IKEA furniture, chances are that you will not get any kind of a manual. You will actually get or any kind of thing. You'll get a graph or a chart with illustrations, which will tell you exactly what will go where and how to fit it. Okay. You don't require any kind of expert. Anyone who can understand that particular, you know, graph or a chart will be able to assemble the furniture for you easily. Okay. They go one step beyond. The graphs and charts or the whatever instructions they provide, they don't have any kind of a text into it. There's nothing verbose over there. It's all picture, right? But those pictures are so powerfully indicated that without even, you know, reading anything, you can figure out how to assemble IKEA furniture. So that's also a kind of a visual management over here. Okay. So visual management is again very powerful when you use it in the correct way on the shop floor. The next tool which I have identified here is the total productive maintenance. Once you have got the baseline done of the 5S, you have got your visual management in place, you start, you know, further stabilizing your operations using the TPM, which is the total productive maintenance. Okay. Now, if everything is organized, you have even an effective communication and other things established, then in that case, the next step becomes is how do you reduce the machine downtime within the production process? Okay. And goal will always be to limit the downtime as much as possible so that your production efficiency can increase over here. So TPM has three main components. One, it focuses on the preventive maintenance, which can include plant maintenance activities that are regularly scheduled. The maintenance staff will perform those periodically throughout the year. And it also includes checking all the equipment for problems and fixing any kind of the issues into it. The goal will remain in the preventive maintenance is to prevent problems before they can occur. The second goal TPM has is corrective maintenance. The managers and the maintenance team check the equipment and determine whether problematic equipment needs to be replaced altogether. Often, it is more cost effective to replace the equipment before they break. Okay? So replacing equipment can also often increase the efficiency and profits. Just an example, if you take the car or your scooter for service, after a certain number of the kilometers the vehicle has run, it makes sense to change the spark plug over there because it wears out. Okay. Now, good vehicles will have a longer spark plug life cycle, but at end of the life cycle, it has to be replaced. Otherwise, it can lead to misfirings. It can lead for, you know, issues into the continuous rhythmic sparking of your fuel into the cylinders, and it may not produce the right kind of the power. Okay. So that's corrective maintenance. The third thing with the TPM focuses upon is the maintenance prevention. And this is a procedure which makes sure that all the equipments bought is exactly what is needed. Okay. Buying faulty or incorrect equipment, that can also result in increased maintenance responsibilities, and it also leads to lower efficiencies in the production. So these are the three areas where the TPM focuses upon. TPM has 8 pillars, and each of those pillars work in tandem along with 5S, visual controls, workplace organization, and it requires a total employee participation. Again, lengthy topic, a large area, probably we can have a session on this also and discuss that more in detail some point later on. The next one, important tool from my side is the POCA UK. Okay. The error proofing, mistake proofing, the way you want to call it, a lot of people call it mistake proofing, a lot of people call it error proofing. POCA UK is the Japanese term. Okay. And again, incidentally, again, it was developed by Toyota and it is very similar to Jidoco. We'll come to the Jidoco after this slide. Idea of the POCA UK is to prevent the mistakes from becoming the defects. So I ignore a mistake and then it manifests on itself, its own, and subsequently it becomes a larger defect. So idea is to stop it before it can become a defect. Okay. And it, one thing is given that in the production, the mistakes can happen. You cannot avoid the mistake 100%, but what is possible is that you can error proof them, you can mistake proof them, so that if the mistakes happen, you actually get a visibility into it, and then you are able to take the corrective actions into it. Okay. So goal over here is to create a form of quality control that would be able to highlight the defects automatically and eventually, you know, take the humans out of the equations and ensure that the error proofing is continuously available. This again was invented because of the multiple human errors seen into the production. And when you perform the repetitive task on a regular basis, there are chances that, you know, you may miss out something or some mistake may happen because of that. So that's where some kind of automation, some kind of, you know, mechanics by which these mistakes can be caught and avoided is what OKUK is all about. Okay. And a good example would be that if you leave your car along with the headlights on and close the door and go out, take out your key, engine code is, you know, detect that there's no key in the keyhole, engine has been shut off, but the headlights are on, it can give you a warning sign. Maybe it can have an audible alarm, which can remind you that, you know, the lights are on. You better, you know, switch off the lights. So that's a mistake proofing. By mistake, I forgot to switch off the lights, but the alarm reminded me to, you know, switch off the lights over here. So that's a mistake proofing. In this particular example also, if you can see, it's a very good example. If I have a plug designed in such a way that it can fit into the female side, only in a certain position, then I am not bothered about whether I am twisting the R into Y into B or whatever, you know, phase changes, and it can avoid the short circuiting. So this is another example of poker yogi. Judoka, that's the next, which is very similar to poker yogi, but different. This incidentally was invented pretty long time back, probably in late 1800s, 1895 or so. And it was used to stop the shuttle of a automatic loom in a case where a thread has broken. So now when you can, you know, automatically find out where the thread has broken into a large loom, then you will also be able to reduce the defects while threading. Okay. So what happens is, if this kind of a system is there, it will allow the operators to operate multiple looms at once and not just remain fixated only on one loom, but rather he can, you know, see that, oh, one loom, some thread is broken, let me go over there, fix it and come back, and the other looms are still going on. So I get the warnings, I get, you know, visual or audio warnings, which can, you know, very clearly tell me what has gone wrong and where it has gone wrong. Okay. So Judoka principle is on four steps again: discover an abnormality or problem, stop the operation process based upon the abnormality, fix the problem at hand where the human intervention can happen, and discover the root cause subsequently to prevent this future issues. That's what the Judoka is. Again, primary innovation, Judoka was brought into the lean manufacturing with the idea that you can examine a manufacturing issue in the middle of the process rather at the end of it. So if my entire manufacturing has happened and then I'm, you know, kind of trying to figure out what has gone wrong, then the cost of fixing that defect can be higher. So Judoka helps you to identify within the manufacturing process in the middle of it itself. Okay. So that's the next tool. SMET, or single minute exchange of dice, is another major tool. Goal of this is to get all changeovers and startups down to less than 10 minutes, a single digit of, you know, time taken to do the changeover. Okay. Now in certain operations, it may not be possible to bring it down to single minute or 9 minutes, but it definitely leads to saying that if I'm taking 4 hours to do certain things, can I bring it down to 1 hour? Can I bring it down to half an hour? So a method which helps you to reduce the changeover times and the startup time is what we call about the single minute exchange of dice. Okay. If possible, each step involved, it should be less than 1 minute. And if we combine that put together, then our, you know, overall number of steps with less than 1 minute per step can help us to improve our changeover time over here. Okay. This was invented long time back, again in 1911, by Frederick Taylor, and it was then later on used by the Ford Motors very heavily in 1915 onwards for, you know, high production assembly lines over here, where the changeovers have to be done between one model to another, and that's where they use that effectively. Main principles of SMET again are: one, identify all changeover tasks, analyze each task to determine the purpose, determine the low cost solutions, goal, set up a goal which is to reduce the changeover times. Okay, so these are the main principles of the SMET. I'm not going to go into the 7 steps, they are already listed out over here. The 20th tool, which again I find very important, is Kanban. And Kanban is once again a Japanese term, which means, in literally meaning, is single card. And that is what, you know, the Kanban is all about. Earlier, what used to happen is that manufacturing workers would fill out a single card, especially whenever the part was not available. Okay, and this signal card would be sent to the team or employee whose job was to order more of that particular part. So I wanted 5 screws, I have only 1 screw left. You will send out a card. The guys who have to, you know, procure the screws will immediately, looking at the signal card, say that, yeah, I need to get more screws to you, go and procure and then bring it down to you. Okay. Now today, of course, all these processes are computerized. We have large number of the applications. Most of the ERPs have got the Kanban built into that as well. And this can be automated and used very effectively into the production shop floor. Again, goal of the Kanban is to reduce the waste. If parts are only brought when needed, then you are likely to have lesser inventory, lesser space required to store that particular inventory, lesser money required to buy that inventory and waste the time, okay, or save the time. So again, Kanban helps you into reducing the waste. The strategy of Kanban actually creates more efficient process because this strategy is based on the consumer demand. And this is also called, in certain ways, the pull method. Okay. So if there is a lot of demand for a product only, then only we would order more of that particular product's component. If there's no demand, then I would not create the orders or I would not, procure the inventory for that. So Kanban is also based upon the pull methodology overall. Standardized work is the next one. It's a tool where we document current best practices, improve the standard, and ensure that the new standard becomes a baseline for the improvement. Okay. Standardized work improves the three important aspects for the manufacturing process: rate at which products are produced in order to meet the customer demand, operators' work sequence to produce the products at that time rate, and the standard inventory needed to ensure a smooth manufacturing process. So that's where the standardization kind of helps out over here. Okay. Again, if you have a standard working, it helps you to eliminate the waste. You can apply it into any industry. It doesn't hold you back into any kind of a industry-specific constraints over here. Okay. The next tool, important tool, is Endon. This tool, you might have seen it onto a lot of machines. You might have this kind of a beacon which is shown over here, and it will give you the different kind of the signals. What it does is it's basically a signaling system in the manufacturing process. And whenever there is an abnormality or some sort of a important action is required, it gives you a visual signal, visual as well as sometimes even auditory kind of a signal that attention is required by the operator, supervisors, or the right kind of the people over here. Okay, we use these Endon lights largely in manufacturing on the assembly lines. Different color lights are used to signal the different problems and actions required. Operators may turn on and on to signal that there is a problem in an assembly line or in an office setting. I can use a red colored light, which could say that, for an example, take the example that operation theater would have a red light on the front saying that the operation theater is in use, please don't go inside. So things like that, these are all the visual signatures or visual signals to indicate that something is happening or something needs attention. Okay. The next tool, which is again very important, is Hijunka. Okay. Hijunka is a Japanese word again for labeling, production labeling or evenness. Right? This is meant to label the type and quantity of the production and while reducing the batching overall. Okay. Hijunka would help you to again reduce the inventory, capital cost, manpower, and also the production time to a minimum. Many lean experts say that Hijunka would be best implemented only after a company has already implemented some of the basic lean principles. Okay. Those lean principles would be workplace organization using the 5S, the standardization of the work, visual management, all kind of your TPM, that is the product, total productive maintenance, and so on and so forth, so that there is already some kind of a, baseline stability into the organization, and now you go for taking out the unevenness into your entire operation. So that's why they say that, it is better if you have got some of these basic lean principles already in your company before you try the Hijunka over here. Okay, so that's the other. Now, as I said, there are, once again, large number of the other tools which you can use. Some are big tools, some are very simple tools. You can use the Yamazumi boards, which is also connected back with the Hijunka. You can use the work balancing. You can do the shop floor auditing. You can have the product family metrics. You can have the SOPs. You can have work instructions. You can do the control planning. You can use n number of the other tools. But the 11 tools which I mentioned are, as per me, more important when it comes down to deploying them on the shop floor to make things better on a lean manufacturing. Okay. As I mentioned, I left out two other important areas, and I could have taken them into some of the other area, like maybe the data collection or maybe understanding the performance or anything else. But I chose to keep them separate because what happens is that if you would have seen, the lean management is all about controlling the losses and wastages. Okay, so that's why I kept them outside, saying that the two other important tools become the big losses, six big losses, and the last one, seven wastages. Okay. Again, I'm not going to talk too much over here. Six big losses, they will always refer to the six big, most common reasons for the inefficient production. TPM and OEE are generally, you know, used to eliminate the six big losses. And the six big losses are the breakdowns, setup adjustments, idling, reduced speed, defects, and the reduced yield. So these are the six big losses. Again, very, very important areas. And these are nothing but a framework for attaching the most common caused causes of wastage into the manufacture. Okay, so these are the six major ones. The other thing comes in the seven wastages. We did the Muda Mura Muri last time, and we did talk about the seven wastages plus one, which is the talent. Again, I'm not going to go more in detail trying to explain that, which are these, you know, what do these seven wastages talk about. If you identify these seven wastages, if you use these tools to understand that where the wastage is happening, you can focus upon how to improve your processes in each area so that, you know, these wastages can be avoided. Okay. These wastages, once again, are the part of the Toyota production system. Just to list it out, the seven wastages are overproduction, waiting, transporting, inappropriate processing, unnecessary inventory, excessive motion, and defects. And as we said last time, seven plus one, the eighth one is unutilized talent. So these are the other seven wastages. So these are the, you know, 25 tools which I identified. As I mentioned, you can have few more other tools, which again, you know, based upon your organization, you may place higher importance. How do you manage your demand? How do you set up the smart goals? Maybe failure mode, effective analysis, lean audits, total quality management, continuous improvement. All these things become, you know, the important part. We did talk about the Kaizen as part of the continuous improvement. So partially I did address that, but continuous improvement doesn't come only by the Kaizen. Continuous improvement could include Kaizen, setup reduction, you know, wastage management. Almost all the lean tools used in one way or the other would help you to continuously improve upon. Okay, so some of these tools probably in the future, we will talk about that. Okay. So, as we talked about, lean manufacturing uses actually large number of tools to improve the production and efficiency by getting the most out of the each resource deployed on the shop floor, okay, or in your business processes. Kaizen, 5S, visual management, value stream mapping, PDCA, OEE, tech time, Gemba walk, Okayoke, SMED, all these are important tools. And, you know, there may be several more which you can, you know, feel them more, but these are, you know, more important tool as per me. Okay. Why all these tools, as I said right in the beginning itself, can be deployed independently, but best results are always achieved when you have the combination of these tools, principles and philosophies applied based upon the scenario to scenario. Okay. Certain tools will help in improving productivity or efficiency directly, while some tools will be assistive in implementation. They may not directly help you into improving the productivity, but they become supportive tools over here. So it is important to understand each of the tool in the very detail, its application, benefits, and the purposes, how to implement, and the supportive activities you can use these tools for. Okay. So this is what the 25 important tools in Lean are. Okay. Friends, I hope that you like this session. I fully understand that this is not an exhaustive list or complete detailing of each tool, but I'm hoping that you got at least some kind of, you know, overview of each of these tools. As always, Auro and Skill Intelligent can always help you and your company in learning and implementing these tools effectively. You can always contact Mr. Kishore Sharma for the same. What we have done is that so far there have been 14 sessions. This is the 15th session. So we have also aggregated all the videos of the past sessions in YouTube. What you can do is you can search for Skill Intelligent channel on the YouTube and subscribe to it. We will be posting more videos over there apart from these 14, 15 sessions which we have, which will also be helpful in understanding these principles of the lean and lean concepts better over here. We are also coming up with some knowledge site, which will also have a lot of insights, a lot of lean practices, blogs, knowledge articles, experience sharing by the professionals in the industry. And idea is to, you know, share all this knowledge along with everyone very openly, very transparently. Okay. As that site gets ready also, we will also keep you posted and update you about that as well. Please share your feedback, whatever you have liked, what you would want us to improve upon in these sessions, what else should we, you know, kind of discuss, what are the new things which we should talk about, and so on and so forth. So that's what we will be getting more in detail over here. Okay. So please give us the feedback that will help us to improve and also help us to share better along with you. So thank you everyone for participating and listening in. Kishore, if we have questions, then, you know, we can take up those questions. Thank you everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such a wonderful presentation. Yes, we do have a few questions coming in.
Sure.
The first question says, if you can please explain about Kanban.
Okay, so Kanban is basically a pull system. And Kanban is a system which basically ensures that you produce or you procure the material for only what you have to produce for what the customer demands. Okay. So if the customer is demanding the 5 part, then we should produce only the 5 parts for the customer. We should not produce 6, 7, 8, or 9 parts for the customer. Okay. So how do we ensure that our manufacturing is all, you know, aligned or rather indirectly controlled by what the customer is demanding, or how the customer's pull is actually creating our manufacturing process is what the Kanban is all about. Okay. Interesting, because you asked this question, and the next session we have been actually thinking of was to get into the Kanban itself and explain the Kanban in detail and, you know, share even the certain case studies, how we have implemented the Kanban and how the people have actually benefited out of it. So please join the next session. We'll talk more in detail about that.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Now, the next question comes in. What is the difference between continuous flow and one piece flow?
So essentially the difference between these two is very, very narrow. Okay. And a lot of people even use, you know, one piece flow and continuous flow as interchangeable terms also. Both are opposite of the batch production. Continuous flow is more associated with the Kanban and just in time and so on and so forth. And it is continuous flow is to ongoingly examine and improve the process to integrate all elements of the production. Okay? Whereas the one piece flow is the sequence of a product or service through a process where you produce or you focus on one unit at a time. Okay. So it may not be continuous flow as such from that concept. I'm focusing on one unit to be completed out. Whereas in the continuous flow, I may have the 30 units in one go, but going through a continuous flow of the process over there. So that's a kind of a difference over here, but very, very narrow. So again, another topic, we are going to pick it up and discuss more in detail some point, because this is also a very important area.
Thank you. The next question. For textile manufacturing factory, what is useful?
Quite a lot. Textile manufacturing facility, Kanban is very important, because I have seen textile companies building up inventory in a huge way. They consume the space, they consume the money, and waste is generated out of that. Setup time is again very important over there, because whenever you are changing the product or the design or the quality, then your machines have to be set up to accept the new product line. So setup reduction is again another important part. OEEE or TPM, both two together, is also very important, because efficiency of your equipment, availability of your equipment is important. You cannot have the downtime of the machine, because the downtime results into low production. So having the TPM OE is also very important over there. Root cause analysis and related things will be important to you, primarily because if there is a breakdown and breakdown is continuously happening, or there is a quality issue which is coming in, the root cause analysis helps you to avoid those kind of the things from repeating over there. So of the 25 tools which I talked about, I can easily say that 15 to 16 of these tools in different combinations will be important in the different areas of textile manufacturing very easily.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The next question, if you can explain five whys.
Five whys in a very simple way. I would ask, if you say that, why did you go to this particular place? That's the first why. Once I come to know that you went for this, I would try to understand the core reason of your going over there by asking another why. So I go up to the different five levels. Each five why is constructed in a particular philosophy and in a particular way, which helps you to, as you start drilling down with five whys, every time asking the why in a repetitive manner, it helps you to unearth that what has actually really happened and understand the real, root cause, or understand the full sequence of the events which has happened over here clearly. So five whys is a very simple technique, but very effective technique. It is part of the problem solving techniques. I've been thinking about taking up a session on the most effective ways of selecting the problem solving tools, or identifying the right kind of the problem solving tool. Probably we will take up that as part of it, and also explain you that how the five whys also will work over there.
Thank you, sir. The second question, which process is better for cement manufacturing?
Cement manufacturing is a continuous process, yet it is a batch process. So I don't know which process you are meaning over here by, but if you're trying to say that which tools will be rather better for the cement manufacturing, then once again, as I said, that there are going to be several tools, or majority of the things which we have identified over here will apply. Continuous flow is one important part, which will be directly applicable into the cement manufacturing. Value streams will be very important, because to sustain the continuous flow, you have to have the smooth, supply chain and logistics planned out into it. So evening out your supply chains using the value streams also will be very important over there.
Thank you. Next question. How are six big losses different from seven lean based?
So big losses are essentially more onto the machine and machine operations. Let me go back over here and then maybe show you. So if you see this six losses, what are these? Equipment failure, setup and adjustment onto the equipment, any kind of idling or a minor stop onto the equipment, reduce the speed of the equipment, or a defect being generated while working on that particular machine because of some machine issue, or the machine not performing at the top speed or the top capacity. These are all machine related kind of the losses. Okay. Whereas when we talk about the wastes, these are the wastes which have happened other than the machine. That could be, I am taking a lot of time, I am waiting somewhere, I've got excess inventory, I'm overproducing, I'm overprocessing, I'm transporting the things from one distance to another, or defects are coming in from somewhere else, but not in the manufacturing, some other area. So these ways are different, and losses are different. Losses are more on the machine, whereas the defects, or sorry, wastes are related to other processes involved into your entire manufacturing.
Thank you, sir. The next question, why quality circle is not considered as important lean tool?
So quality circle is what is quality circle? It's made up of group of people who are doing the same thing or similar work and focus on resolving or improving the resolving a issue or improving a particular area or activity using variety of the statistical tools, problem solving tools, maybe things like a SMAD, maybe things like, you know, your value streams, maybe things like root cause analysis, whatever, you know, you have multiple of these two things you would be using. So Quality Circle as such is not a lean tool, but it is rather mechanism of improving using the various lean tools. Okay, so that's why we don't call the Quality Circle as a lean tool by default. It's a philosophy or a principle which uses the several lean tools, and it's a method of improving the quality on a recurring basis. We take it more as part of the continuous improvement side of it.
Thank you, sir. Next question. What about KPIs, FMEA, etc.?
So KPIs and FMEA and other things are also important. But as I said, my personal choice was slightly different. You can put them also as your high priority. KPI or the key performance indicator are usually the metrics which company uses to provide the goals and targets for various aspects of the business, where the failure mode and effects analysis is a kind of a structured approach to discovering the potential failures which may be even existing within the design of a product or design of your process or complete operations over here. So they're also important tools. These are also the ways of identifying the waste and removing them, or measuring your performance overall. KPI more on the performance, FMEA more on identifying the root causes and analyzing that. But it's a matter of preference. That's it.
Thank you, sir. I think we have come to the end of session. No more questions. So thank you, Atul sir, for apprising us on the top 25 lean tools. In any business, two of the most expensive and the most common types of problems has to do with the efficiency and the product wastage. And to overcome this problem, lean manufacturing comes into practice. Lean manufacturing is also referred to as the lean production. Lean production is all about creation of value. Whatever is not included in the category of creating value for the company is considered as waste. Today we have learned there are many tools in lean manufacturing which can help in achieving the goal of continuous success, provided they are implemented well. Well, I have come across with many organizations, those have tried implementing it, but somehow not been able to achieve the desired results. So implementation that effectively is very much important. We at our university and Skill Intelligent are here to support you in implementing such best practices in your organization to achieve the desired results. You may like to contact us for any such queries. Thank you very much for all of you to be a part of this session. I would like to share with you the next session. As Atul sir said, we are planning to have it on the Kanban. And we will share the details with you shortly, maybe by tomorrow or so, day after, we'll be sharing the details about the session timings and everything. Right? So I take this opportunity to thank Atul sir for being with us and apprising us on the subject. I would like to thank all the participants and look forward to see you again next week with the next session. Thank you very much and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.